If you have seen a number of my previous videos, you may have discovered there are some common themes in it. Besides the obvious emphasis on evolutionary psychology, this is the idea that we as humans are not always able to change the world to our own ideologies and ideals. We are not the masters of the universe. Sometimes it's better to accept things as they are and stop struggling with reality, as you will never win. Save your energy for the battles you can win. One of those myths we seem unable to get rid of is the idea that we as parents are responsible for the entire future of our kids, that we shape their personalities, virtues and vices. Of course, we should shelter and protect them, provide them with everything they need, give them all the love in the world and be there to help them in any possible way. But that's about it. Forget you can do much on the final happiness of your child, on his talents and ambitions, his personality and mental troubles, his future career or marital status. All these variables are influenced by many other factors than are given in your hands. This may be hard to accept right now, but I hope after this video this sounds a little bit less weird as it does now. For this episode on evolutionary psychology, I owe very much to the ideas of Annemie Ploeger and her great book, The Evolutie van een Kind. Unfortunately, this is only available in the Dutch language. Another inspirational book is from Judith Rich Harris, called The Nurture Assumption, Why Children Turn Out the Way They Do. This book was published at the time my own children were born and were growing up, and it really helped me to be a better father. That is, accepting you have only limited influence on the way your kids turn out to be as adults. In a way, it was my initiation into what you could call parenting zen. Accept the way things are and don't try, or don't even think you can, change very much on how your darlings will develop. And believe me, that was not easy for me. But let's start at the very beginning, at the point the infant isn't even there. Let's have a look at the essential patterns in human procreation and fertility. For one, human fertility starts at a very late age, much later than in most mammals. This, to a certain degree, also goes for chimps and other near relatives. Chimps in the wild start being fertile at the age of about 11 years. In zoos, where they are better fed, this starts a bit earlier, about 8 years of age. In humans, we see a similar pattern. In rich Western countries, young girls start menstruating earlier than their sisters in developing countries where resources are scarce or people living as hunter-gatherers. In the West, women with anorexia or having very low fat levels because of, for example, high-intensity sports, think of female bodybuilders or long-distance runners, also experience delay of ovulation or even temporary infertility. So, wealth makes you fertile at an earlier age. This tendency, however, is balanced with an equally strong opposing force. When life is unpredictable and resources are scarce, humans tend to shorten their time span, their time horizon. They become more impulsive, are going to live more by the day and refrain from long-term planning. Take what you can get today, because tomorrow it might be gone. This leads to impulsive behaviors, among others, starting having kids at an earlier age, even when you are not fully prepared to give them all the care they need. Teen pregnancies are especially common among girls living in highly unpredictable circumstances or having faced mental abuse or other psychological disturbing situations. From their inborn quality strategy, these young women switch to a quantity strategy, forced to by circumstances. Luckily, we encounter this less and less in the Western world. This is reflecting the absolute wealth we are living in today. In Holland, women get their first child at an average age of about 29 years old. This has never happened before in human history. So, at the one hand, girls become fertile at a younger age, and at the same time, they are having their first baby at an unusual late age. And maybe this is something we shouldn't be too happy about. Maybe the strategy of delaying having kids is not that smart. We know older parents are, as seen from a medical viewpoint, serious risk factors for the well-being and healthy development of the fetus. Some severe problems can derive from having old parents, especially having an older mother. Something to consider for young couples: why not having babies at an earlier, more natural age? and do all those exciting things like traveling the world at a later age. When at 40 or 45 your kids are grown up, you have plenty of time to lead the Peter Stuyvesant way of life. For one thing, it's much better for the health of your offspring. And because of the limited age gap, you can much more participate in joint activities with your kids, like playing sports together. But back to the evolutionary perspective. Pluger mentioned an important reason why specifically women in the human species become fertile at such a late age. This has to do with patrilocality. It's most of the time the women that move to new groups, as proven by the much bigger geographical dispersion of female mitochondrial DNA. The males stay in the groups they were born in. This is the pattern found in most hunter-gatherer groups, as well as in the case of most of our cousin primate species. Going to a new group is a big, often stressful transition. You lack a network of family and friends and depend entirely on your husband and his family. So women had to be strong, flexible, mature and intelligent to make this transition in a successful way. Therefore, you better did not make this step at an age too young. Why boys procreate at a later age? That has totally different causes. Competition between males is very intense, as we have seen in previous episodes. So they anyhow will only be able to procreate when fully developed, strong and skilled. Until that time, they are always overpowered by older males. But this is not the whole story. Another remarkable fact is, the bigger and more advanced the brains of a species, the later in life the species starts reproducing. And the bigger the brains in apes and monkeys, the bigger and more complex the social groups they are living in. These two factors, of course, point in the same direction, the importance of culture in our species. Like most life forms, we are equipped with inborn reflexes, impulses, preferences, and fixed behavioral patterns. Most things we do to survive, we don't have to learn. We do it in the right way by ourselves. But of all species, Homo sapiens is by far the most cultural animal, that's for sure. Us being children for so long is a function of us being cultural animals. In hunter-gatherers, young kids take up quite serious responsibilities at a very young age. But that doesn't mean schooling is over by then. For some specific complex hunting techniques, they only fully master the desired skills at an average age of about 35. And some never do, which is, because of the division of labor, not a big problem. You just specialize in something else. But, as a little sidestep, this shows our modern forced separation of schooling and working life is quite unnatural, maybe even harmful, as I have explained in an earlier episode. Another remarkable way we differ from most other species is the involvement of others in the upbringing of children. This literally starts at birth. In all other species, females are quite capable of delivering their babies all by themselves. They don't need help for this. This in stark contrast with humans. In all civilizations known, women are held by other women when they deliver a baby. This has to do with our specific bodily features, like walking on two legs, the shape of our pelvis, and of course, the unusual big brain of the human newborn baby. All this makes giving birth to an unusual heavy and risky endeavor, and women often cannot do without extra help of others. Another remarkable feature is the role others play in the upbringing of children. When the baby is born, many people come to see it, and the new parents are not reluctant to hand it over and have it carried and cuddled by their family, friends and neighbors, something a chimp or gorilla would never do. Remarkable detail, relatives of the mother tend to stress how much the baby resembles his father, how much it looks like him and how many facial features correspond. Why? Probably they want to assure him he really is the father. Because if he starts to doubt, this might lead to killing the baby and him abandoning his wife, something the maternal grandmothers want to avoid at all costs. In the end, it's about their genes too. Research, and you probably confirmed this from your own personal experience, show the relationships children have with their maternal grandparents is overall more intense and close, and I receive more support and resources from them in comparison to paternal grandparents. Anthropologists found out the amount of time fathers spend with their kids in different hunter-gatherer tribes varies a lot, depending for a great deal on the way hunting and gathering takes place. If it was with spears, hunting big game, children were of course less involved. If it was about hunting with traps and nets and driving little prey to these strategic points, women and small children were involved too, and fathers spent much more time with their kids doing so. But independent of the time fathers spent with their kids, the time non-parents were involved turned out to be remarkably similar. So the idea of kindergartens matches quite well with our evolutionary fundamentals. But wait, why are other members of the group prepared to take care of the children not their own? What's the evolutionary logic behind this? Animals will not spend time and resources on youngsters not their own. Well, quite simple. We evolved in groups that mainly consisted of close relatives, family or extended family groups. So every member, every kid, was in some way genetically related to you. Therefore, taking care for every little kid nearby was a wise choice seen from the perspective of the genes. We call this inclusive fitness. That's why we feel the urge to cuddle and care for youngsters from even from other species, like little puppies or kittens. A seagull, living in colonies of non-related individuals, would never do this. Instead, he would just eat the chick of his neighbors if they didn't prevent him from doing so. On the other hand, in species living in family groups, incidents are recorded of helping and even caring for individuals of non-related species, like dolphins saving humans from drowning, or wolves adopting orphans and nursing them. Why do babies cry? One might think this could be very dangerous in the conditions we lived in for millions of years, attracting hungry predators. But this is, as weird as it may seem, precisely the reason children do this. They feel unsafe. Parents naturally react to it by running to the child, lifting it up, comforting and protecting it. The idea of some so-called nurture gurus not to reward crying by comforting the child may sound reasonable from a purely behavioristic point of view, but evolutionary psychologists, as well as most parents, would seriously frown on it, and with good reasons. The idea that it makes children more autonomous and independent is clearly shown to be wrong. In fact, it's just the other way around. Anthropologists are always surprised by the great level of independence and superior social skills of young children and hunter-gatherer communities. Maybe this has to do too with the near absence of physical punishment. The Aka pygmies are known never to spank their children. They are a kind of natural followers of Rousseau. And most kids in hunter-gatherer communities have much more contact with their mother, physically as well as psychologically, compared to kids in the West. Practices, by the way, of correcting or even spanking children vary greatly across different cultures. The general pattern is that hunter-gatherers are the most permissive to their children, and cattle herders, agriculturists and city dwellers the least. One explanation is these last groups have much more valuable possessions that need taking care of. Young Maasai boys go out with their cattle and are expected to guard it with their lives. Negligence is punished severely. Another explanation can be agriculture societies tend to be structured in hierarchies with big power distances. Where power and violence are normal in everyday life, it will be accepted in raising children too. Also, the habit of having the baby not in your own bed while sleeping lacks any basis from a biological viewpoint. The fear you might unintentionally choke the baby when rolling on it lacks any empirical evidence. Moreover, I can tell you from my personal experience, when having a baby, you are super sensitive not to lay on anything that could be your baby. At that time, I woke up many times a night, terrified I was crunching my little boy, while in fact I was laying on what appeared to be no more than a bump of blankets. Remarkable how ancient instincts suddenly pop up to do their good work. In many, what we call primitive societies, families, sometimes extended families, sleep in bigger groups in one room. This is very comforting for these babies and toddlers. Being far away from their mothers is in fact a quite unnatural way of raising kids. These lucky youngsters are able to observe much more of adult life, on work, but also on social and private issues. They see parents quarrel and are not far away when they are having sex. Probably not openly, but they notice what is going on beneath the blankets or in a dark corner in the room. Privacy is only a recent invention. The big moral and emotional weight these issues have in our societies is absent in these cultures and makes living more relaxed. But it's not always a happy paradise in the old societies. Some evolutionary psychologists suggest the crying of the baby also has an element of blackmailing in it. When it cries, it attracts predators. That's of course dangerous for himself, but also for his parents and the others around. But by crying, it monopolizes all the attention to himself, at the detriment of, for example, his siblings or other kids needing protection too. The evolutionary logic is clear. A baby shares 100% of his genes with himself, but only 50% with his mother or with other siblings. So putting them in danger to save his own life is genetically seen a wise strategy, however weird it may appear to us. We know of many other species where siblings push each other out of the nest or even cannibalize each other just to survive themselves. That's why siblings, especially in the case of small age differences, quarrel and fight so much. They have shared interests, but are competitors on so many other domains too. Mothers tend to talk to their babies in a very specific way. We call this motherese. It consists of slow speaking with a strong emphasis on certain vowels and is usually spoken in a high and happy tone. Therefore, it's sometimes called happy talk too. But however, babies really need this. They show a strong preference for voices speaking in this way. And depressed mothers who cannot produce motherese seriously hurt their babies doing so. This kind of talking helps the baby to understand the structure of a specific language and it makes it easier for him to imitate words and tones. So never feel childish when you do it yourself. It's good for the kid. At the age after being a baby, kids grow to toddlers and experience their first puberty. They start walking, develop a concept of the self, and explore the world around them with their new gained skills. In Western societies, this age comes with frequent tantrums and short but fierce conflicts with their parents or caretakers. But is this a natural phenomenon, just a biological phase like so many other phases, or has it to do with our culture-determined ways of handling kids? For example, we much more than other cultures tend to limit the freedom and autonomy of kids. Jared Diamond, in his brilliant book, The World Until Yesterday, tells of people in New Guinea letting their youngsters do things we would be shocked by. If a child wants to play with a sharp knife, okay, he will learn himself what he can and cannot do with it. A toddler coming too close to a fire, the feeling of heat will prevent him from burning himself, would be the response of the elders. Just as with heights, many of these people live in tree houses to prevent poisonous insects and other vermin coming in. The entrance is no more than an opening in the floor. Did the parents assemble protective railings or other means to prevent kids falling down? No way. Every child has a natural fear of heights, so when it looks down once, it will avoid these dangerous openings. And because limitation of autonomy is so rare, these children display much less tantrums than their Western peers. Could we maybe learn something from them? Traditionally, the communities we lived in were relatively small, meaning for kids there were only a few peers of exactly the same age. Hence, a pattern we find in many such cultures is children play and learn in mixed age groups, and not, as in our school system, in groups of same age peers. And this is not at all just an accidental situation. It turns out to have many advantages, even evolved ones. First of all, a 1 year older friend is a more realistic role model than a grown-up man of 35. Okay, little kids try to imitate the fighting of knights, sport heroes, and visible work of grown-ups, like builders and truck drivers. But the imitation stays poor. On the other hand, imitating a slightly older friend that can ride a bike without holding the handlebar can, after some practicing, be copied fully successful. So kids focus on their slightly older peers for role models and ideals. And the universality of this phenomenon points at biological evolutionary roots of it. Children want to wear the clothes their slightly older role models do, want to master the competencies they have, imitate their ways of talking and acting, copying their opinions, and so on. It's a known fact, children speak the language and dialects of their peers, not of their parents. Kids of immigrants, in almost all cases, speak the language of their new country better than their parents do, and all for good reasons. Judith Harris tells us, later in life, they have to deal with the people which now are kids too, not with their parents. So, what mom and dad wants always meets a healthy level of resistance. One of the many eye-openers Harris provided me was this. Kids as kids don't try to be successful adults. They try to be successful kids. When you look at it through this lens, much of what didn't understand about child behavior now suddenly fully makes sense. In our societies, the copying children do is almost always limited to playing and acting as. School too is limited to simulations. This in stark contrast to most of our history, where kids were quite young already having serious responsibilities. Nayaka children in the south of India go out hunting small game from the age of 6 or 7, not as play, but to provide real food for the family. Young Maasai are herding cattle, the most precious possession of this tribe, and are expected to defend it with their lives. Young girls at the age of 7 or 8 are expected to take care of babies under sometimes dangerous circumstances. Of course, demands put on these youngsters are always realistic, tailor-made for their age and development. So kids learn these skills from peers slightly older than they are, and only later in life learn the really complex skills, as grown-up adults of 30 are expected to master. By the way, these kids never experience the existential crisis our juveniles so often go through. Puberty is seldom as problematic as here in the West. A feeling of sense, purpose, and identity comes natural. They are important and they know it. In peer groups, children take on different roles. One is the leader, the other the clown or mediator. These roles much more determine behavior and positions later in life than the roles they perform at home. Furthermore, attitudes of youngsters toward, for example, school and getting high grades is to a large degree determined by their peer groups. Whether kids take school seriously, whether they start smoking or not, or enter into crime, is more determined by friends than by family, as is one of the core ideas proposed by Judith Harris. That's why it's so hard to change dysfunctional cultures. Blaming or pressing the parents is never of any help, while on the other hand, getting grip on the cultures of juveniles is notorious difficult too. In fact, it can be realized only by establishing a kind of totalitarian institutions. The British did so. In the very elite public schools like Eton, Harrow and Rugby, young boys grew up in a specific culture that molded them into the ideal soldiers, officers and civil servants to run the vast British empires. These schools, these peer groups, could achieve what no single parent could achieve on his own. The upbringing of children was taken over by the state. Mind you, here the dream of Plato and communist dictators had already come true. But being in multi-age peer groups has several more clear advantages. Anthropologists observed the games these kinds of groups are usually less competitive than are, for example, in the West. Why? It's too easy to win a game from a boy 2 years younger than you are. This gives no satisfaction. So, natural, games tend to switch to more cooperative, non-competitive forms of play. Older peers develop responsibility and social skills guiding and teaching the younger ones. From a young age, they are in fact trained to become skilled parents and leaders. Studies show young caregivers know intuitively what to ask and what to give to their younger peers. So young kids are more lenient, but by growing older, rules become more strict. And it is, for instance, not allowed anymore to behave in an irresponsible, antisocial way or ignoring agreements, keep resources for yourself, or refuse to help youngsters and peers in need. Jane Goodall tells the story of a man with a heavily mutilated face. This was caused when he, as a 6-year-old kid, had to take care of his baby brother. When a raiding chimp tried to catch the baby to eat it, the 6-year-old boy attacked and chased the big chimp with a stick. The baby survived, but the boy was badly hurt in the face. What a hero! And besides that, for the family, this incident was no reason to end the practice of having babies guarded by kids maybe a few years older. Accidents do happen, they must have thought. Anna Freud, the daughter of Sigmund Freud, reports on a group of 6 children, aged 3 to 4. They were during the war together in a concentration camp, and there were no adults to take care of them. So they had to survive on their own under very harsh conditions. When Allied soldiers found them, they were brought to England, where Anna Freud could observe them. She noticed the kids were very brutal, aggressive, and rejected toward any adult, but showed remarkable care, generosity, and loyalty to each other. This again shows the resilience and adaptability of children and how in-group cohesion can be very strong. The older, we're still talking about little kids, did a remarkable way take care of the youngsters, even under the most extremes of circumstances. These and other stories of young children having to go through the most horrible ordeals and coming out of this as sane, happy, and relatively well-adjusted juveniles and adults undermines the great myth Anna Freud's father has launched into our thinking. The concept that childhood is all determining of how someone's personality, adult life, and mental well-being will turn out to be. That childhood traumas can never in fact be overcome. Let's face it for what it is, a serious, fallacious idea. Reality is, genes and peers are what determine to the greatest extent what the adult will be the child is growing in. In her book, Judith Rich Harris sums up a number of these incidents, all proving the same fact that children can overcome the most horrific circumstances in life if they are later to become part of a loving group or family. Like research on post-traumatic growth is showing, people and even little children have such an unbelievable high level of resistance and resilience. They can overcome almost anything, as long as they are part of a loving group, be it peers or be it family, or get the chance to become so later after the ordeals. Just like the new language of immigrants, culture is mostly transferred by children. Therefore, it takes only 1 or 2 generations before newcomers really get assimilated into a new culture. The transfer of culture from kid to kid is remarkably stable. British research revealed the outdoor games children play at the schoolyard and on the streets are exactly the same as children did 200 or 300 years back. Some even date back to Roman times. Important aspects of culture is largely transferred to the younger generations. So make sure immigrant children mingle with bigger groups of native children. When parents are trying to prevent their kids from bad influences by prohibiting them watching certain TV programs, this is in almost all cases in vain. Their children are not influenced directly by the television programs, but by their peers looking at exactly the same television programs too. Juvenile delinquency is best predicted by the neighborhood in which youngsters grow up. When they move to a neighborhood with less crime, their crime rates will magically decrease too. Note, bringing them to jail is bringing them to a neighborhood that will probably vastly increase their criminal tendencies. I don't have the answer to this problem, but it is something we should seriously be thinking about. Sociologist Janet Scofield found out black and white kids sometimes hold very different norms about school performances. If a black kid performs well, he will be ridiculed by his black friends and is accused of acting white. So, when we want to understand the big ethnical gaps in educational success and IQ scores, it's no use asking the parents. They all say school is important and they really mean it. But to look at the actual behavior and cultures of the kids themselves. In an earlier video, I plead for sex-segregated schools. Research confirms this. All black schools deliver students with much higher SAT scores. In all female schools, girls perform better on typical STEM disciplines. Why? In mixed schools, group segregation often follows the lines of gender or ethnicity. Female groups contrast themselves by boy groups, and not wanting to be as they are entails not being good in STEM disciplines. And in black groups, the norm is not to act white, meaning do not try to excel with high grades. In all female or all black schools, we don't encounter this problem. The core message of Harris' book is that behavior, personality, traits, talents, and even mental problems are caused for about 50% by genes. The next powerful factor is peers. They contribute to about 40% of the variants we encounter. So there's only 10% left for the parents. This means, of course, on average. Someone reading the book, The Nurture Assumption, and thinks he's going to change the destiny of his kids anyhow, does have two options at hand to do so. First, he can influence the future of his kids by his own partner choice. Just look for better genes before marrying someone, or look for a suitable sperm donor to get the desired traits in your children. The second option is to move to a new neighborhood. Have a look at the kids walking around in your streets. Don't you like them? Well, to prevent your kids becoming like them, move to a neighborhood the youngsters appear more to your taste. It's up to you to choose. What about genes? They count for half of the outcomes. Which inherited traits make people happy and successful, or not happy and not successful? Research on this is quite conclusive. Of course, on top of the list there is IQ. In the infamous book of Murray and Hernstein, The Bell Curve, they give an overwhelming number of cases where IQ makes an all-important difference, from school success to health, income, happiness, and numerous other things. Having a low IQ is a serious life handicap. Variance in IQ has for about 60 to 70% genetic causes. Other crucial traits dictating happiness and success are impulsivity, aggression, low empathy skills, short span of attention, sensation seeking, and being much more sensitive for reward than for punishment. All these traits are for a good deal genetically inherited. Scientists speak of about 40 to 50%. And we must not forget another important one, physical appearance. Beautiful people are treated differently from not so beautiful people. As to be expected, this is also for a big part a matter of genes. Just like is, for example, obesity. Eating habits matter, but genes do too. To be precise, for 70%, the problem is genetically. Having the wrong traits, or should I say the wrong genes, make you a victim everywhere. Sad, but true. There are a lot of myths, unfounded assumptions, and forthright wrong ideas about parenting and raising children. Freud, Watson, the guy saying, give me 12 children and I make them to whatever you want, and even Rousseau and Dr. Spock have had too much influence on our ideas of parenting and education. A common denominator in these ideas is that parenting really does matter, that parents shape their children into adults, formed to their image and likeness. Judith Rich Harris was the first to really systematically challenge and even refute this idea. We can call her ideas good enough parenting. Of course, you can harm a child by neglecting or abusing it, by withholding proper medical care, nutrition, or other basic biological and psychological needs. But from a certain point on, the impact of parenting is for the biggest part absent. According to Harris, two things do really matter: genes and environment, meaning peers. So, you can have impact on your children by your own genes and by marrying a spouse with the right genes. After this, you can have impact by choosing the neighborhood you are going to live in, because this will be the main factor concerning with which peers your child will interact. And their impact is huge, much bigger than yours as parents. But wait, you might reply. There's an abundance of scientific literature showing that parental style indeed does matter, isn't it? Harris's answer is no. Yes, there are lots of papers saying friendly and caring parents tend to have safely attached and agreeable kids. Parents reading and talking a lot to their children, singing songs together and taking them to museums and theaters are having kids doing well at school and going to museums themselves too. On the other hand, parents spanking and physically abusing their kids tend to have aggressive, antisocial kids that will bully peers, abuse their own kids too, and have a higher chance to be perpetrators of crime, domestic violence, and rape. The mistake scientists in this line of research have made for decades, so Harris proves, is they are mingling cause and effect. As an axiom, they reason the style of parenting influences the behavior of the kid, while Harris argues it can just as well be the other way around, the behavior of the kid determining the style of parenting of the parents. Some kids behave in such a way, physical punishment seems to be the only alternative left. As someone joked once, little John comes from a broken family. I'm not surprised, little John can break any family. Mind you, almost all of these studies in favor of the all-parenting myth are correlational, not experimental. So the causal direction always stays unclear. They show two variables move together, but they don't determine which variable causes which variable to move. Mind you, this odd line of thinking is not purely an academic matter, a subject of discussion between scientists with no real-life consequences. The idea is widely spread in our Western society. One time, for example, autism was claimed to be caused by a cold and harsh style of childcare by especially the mother. Now we know autism is caused by genes. Imagine the pain we have caused to these innocent mothers for so many years. They were punished twice, with the care of a handicapped child, and the blame the condition of their child was because of their own misdeeds. So, what to do with all this knowledge? I think the most important conclusion is, as a parent, please don't do too much. Modern culture has fallen into the trap to think everything is malleable. In essence, we are all technologists, using to solve problems by analyzing and fixing them, planning things, inventing even more ingenious interventions, cures and solutions, be it on the material, natural or human world. We think we can change everything as long as we try hard enough. This is a dangerous fallacy. Yes, we can change some things, maybe many things. But let's accept some things have their own natural way of growing and developing. Accepting this brings you much more peace of mind and will probably result in a better world too, because you can focus your energy and mental power on the things we can do and really can change. Thank you for your attention. This was it for today. Hope to see you in our next video.